morning, Grace Church.
Good morning.
And with the words of St. Francis, we give thanks for Paula, who has stepped in to be our organist this morning. We'll hold Ken in our prayers. He's not feeling well and wishes he could be here for this opening glorious day, but he's here in spirit. Let us praise the Lord. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom. Now and forever. Amen.
Please join me. Almighty God,
to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Exodus. I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. Horse and rider he has thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and my might, and he has become my salvation. This is my God, and I will praise him, my Father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a warrior. The Lord is his name. Pharaoh's chariots and his army he cast into the sea. His picked officers were sunk in the Red Sea. The floods covered them. They went down into the depths like a stone. Your right hand, O Lord, glorious in power, your right hand, O Lord, shattered the enemy. In the greatness of your majesty, you overthrew your adversaries. You sent out your fury. It consumed them like stubble. At the blast of your nostrils, the waters piled up. The floods stood up in a heap. The deeps congealed in the heart of the sea. The enemy said, I will pursue. I will overtake. I will divide the spoil. My desire shall have its fill of them. I will draw my sword. My hand shall destroy them. You blew with your wind. The sea covered them. They sank like lead in the mighty waters. Who is like you, O Lord, among the gods? Who is like you, majestic in holiness, awesome in splendor, doing wonders? Then the prophet Miriam, Aaron's sister, took a tambourine in her hand, and all the women went out after her with tambourines and with dancing. And Miriam sang to them, Sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. Horse and rider he has thrown into the sea. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle is from Romans 14, chapters 1 through 12. A reading from Paul's letter. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall. And they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Let those who observe the day observe it in honor of the Lord. Also those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God. While those who abstain, abstain in the honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God, for it is written, "As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God." So then each will be accountable to God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Said to Jesus, "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times?" Jesus said to him, "Not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him, and as he could not pay, his Lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything.' And out of pity for him, the Lord of that slave released him and forgave the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, "Pay what you owe." Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you." But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he could pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, "You wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you?" And in anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Social media right now that shows Jesus saying to his disciples, "Not 7, but 70 times 7, with one of the disciples doing a facepalm in response, saying, "Oh, great. Not only do I have to forgive, I have to do math." Who's seen it? Show of hands. Some of you. Good. That one resonates. I struggled mightily with math as a kid. I was reading 6th grade books before I started school, but basic arithmetic had me stumped. My father, a mechanical engineer, and whose career revolved around math, tried to help. But this wasn't the remedy that he or my teachers hoped for. At risk of dating myself, a little thing called new math had just made its way into the elementary schools, which confounded my father about as much as the problem sets confounded me. My dad was no paragon of flexible thinking and couldn't see the reason for the new math model. His maxim was, "If it ain't broke, don't fix it." He couldn't see any reason for the change. And that hindered his ability to give the right kind of help. So he had me doing the problems his way. I would get the correct answer, but would get points off for not doing the problems the approved way. We had to show our work, and mine didn't look the way it was supposed to. Homework sessions ended in tears. It was frustrating because I understood that math was important, and I really did want to get it right. Which gives me a real appreciation for our friend Peter. Of course it's Peter. P Peter was struggling with the mathematics of a lived faith. Like my dad, he only knew an old paradigm. And like me, he knew it was important and wanted to get it right. And on some level, I think Peter knew the old paradigm was broken and needed fixing. When he comes up to Jesus and asks, "Lord, how often shall I forgive my brother when he sins against me? Up to 7 times? He's working from an old rabbinic teaching. We must forgive our offenders, but only up to 3 times each. This was well understood by first century Jews, and Matthew presumes this knowledge in his version of the story. Remember, Matthew, more than any of the other gospel authors, draws on a solidly Jewish perspective. Anyway, back to the story. Scripture doesn't speak to Peter's motives, but whether from a desire to impress Jesus, one up the rabbis, or getting it right for his own spiritual well-being, Peter suggests that we up the forgiveness ante to 7. A number considered to be the number of perfection or completion in ancient Jewish numerology. According to one rabbinic teaching, all 7s are beloved. Surely that would be an appropriate number of times to forgive someone, more than the old teaching, and a significant number to boot. Peter's on the right track, and if he doesn't actually show his work, he implies it, but he still gets the answer wrong. That's when Jesus throws some new math at Peter. In the kingdom of God, 7 times still wasn't enough. Jesus effectively says, "Don't bother counting, Pete. Really, don't. That's not even the right model." You see, 70 times 7 also had special meaning in Jewish numerology. It represented far more than the mathematical product of 490. 7 was the number of perfection and completion, but 70 times 10, 10 being another significant number, represented the totality of the world. So 70 times 7 represents perfection and totality, the ultimate number. A number it doesn't even make sense to try to count. A number that speaks to God's unbounded forgiveness, which we, as the body of Christ in the world, are also called to show to one another. No matter how often someone hurts us, we are to forgive them. God's forgiveness doesn't keep score, and neither should ours. It's a foundational aspect of the kingdom of heaven. And Jesus illustrates the magnitude of such forgiveness with a parable. A servant is forgiven a staggering debt. A single talent was worth roughly 20 years' wages for a typical day laborer. Times 10,000. Someone who likes math a lot more than I do calculated the debt at $10 billion, with a B, dollars, based on an equivalent modern salary of $50,000 per year. No way could someone of this means ever make a dent in that kind of debt. Nevertheless, the servant's unpayable debt is compassionately and graciously forgiven by his master. No debtor's prison, no threat of slavery, no lifetime of payments that would leave him and his family destitute. The impossible debt was simply gone. Clean slate. So the servant goes his merry way and runs into someone who owes him a bit of money. 100 denarii. Now, a denarius was roughly a single day's pay. So we're talking about a relatively modest debt. But this rascal, whose master has just let him off the hook for an immense fortune, grabs the guy who owes him a few months' wages by the throat and demands immediate payment. and that got him into bigger trouble with the master than his original debt did, cutting himself off from the master's grace. Jesus shows us that all forgiveness ultimately begins with God. It really doesn't originate in us. We participate in the forgiveness we have received by sharing it. We aren't choosing to forgive so much as we are choosing to share the forgiveness God has already given us. And it's a choice we're called to make over and over again. Don't even bother counting. Just keep choosing. Understanding what forgiveness is and is not helps. As Reverend Jamie said last week, forgiveness is not giving someone a pass for bad behavior, condoning, excusing, or denying it, or giving license to repeat it. It doesn't even necessarily mean that you remain in relationship with the wrongdoer. Consequences for wrongdoing are not unholy. Forgiveness means releasing the vitriol, the resentment, a desire for revenge, or a sense of being owed something, whether we think the wrongdoer deserves that or not. Because it's not about deserving or contrition on the wrongdoer's part. And that's hard to do. It flies in the face of earthly sensibilities, but remember, the kingdom of God's ways are not the world's ways. As members of the body of Christ, we are, as Reverend Nancy said a few weeks ago, a cross-bearing people. We are to deny ourselves and our own egos and let go of everything that speaks to the world's sensibilities. Forgiveness is a big piece of what that looks like. It's what makes us Easter people, how we die to self and rise to a new life, life solidly rooted in kingdom values, not earthly values. That's why we pray, give us this day our daily bread, not give those sinners their just deserts. When we forgive someone, we're effectively saying, God, please don't condemn them for this transgression. Don't give them what their offense deserves. Show them the mercy that you have shown me for my sins. None of this is easy, friends. Our natural tendency is toward retributive justice rather than restorative justice. But kingdom justice is restorative justice. And the only way to that is through the challenging and ongoing work of forgiveness. We are to forgive as many people as we need to, as often as we need to. And it's not always a one and done business either. Sometimes the offense is so great that the work of forgiving is not a discrete event, but the work of a lifetime. I suspect a lot of us were reminded of that this week as we reflected on the horrific events of 9/11 as old pain and anger resurfaced. That's okay. Forgiveness isn't so much a matter of doing as it is an ongoing way of being in the world with one another. Just keep at it. When we refuse to forgive others, we cut ourselves off from God's free-flowing mercy and grace. We are the ones who truly suffer. Forgiveness blesses you even more than the wrongdoer, and hurting people need that blessing. We begin to get a sense of God's new math and why it's important when we begin to have a sense of just how boundless God's grace and mercy are, and when we begin to understand why that matters. We liberate ourselves and others when we extend that to those who have wronged us. We're freed from the control of the past so we can meet the present anew with a clean slate. So let's all embrace this new math. And don't worry about showing your work. It shows itself in transformed lives that manifest the love and mercy of Christ. Blessed are those whose transgressions are forgiven. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord will never count against them. Let us pray. God of mercy, you know that our hearts often wrangle with forgiveness. We struggle mightily to forgive as wholly and fully as you forgive us, and to show the same love and forgiveness that you so freely offer. We thank you for that grace and mercy, and humbly beseech you to grant us the strength and power to forgive others, so they too can show you living in us. In the name of the Holy One, who loves us unconditionally, forgives us perpetually, and empowers us to do the same. Amen.
We believe in one God. To the prayers of the people. With all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all peoples, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our bishop and for all clergy and people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our president, for the leaders of the nation, for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this city, for every city and community, and for those who live in them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the good earth which God has given us, and for the wisdom and will to conserve it, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the aged and infirm,
for the widowed and orphans, and for the sick and the suffering. Let us pray for the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor and the oppressed, for the unemployed and the destitute, for prisoners and captives, for all who remember and care for them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in the hope of the resurrection, and for all the departed, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For deliverance from all danger, violence, oppression, and degradation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That we may end our lives in faith and hope, without suffering and without reproach, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
In the communion of Saint Michael and of all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To thee, O Lord our God.
Let us pray for the needs and concerns of this community. For all affected by the floods in Libya and by Hurricane Lee. For the clients, staff, and volunteers at the 1269 Cafe. For all refugees and those who support them. For the city of Manchester as we elect a new mayor. And for all elected officials. For all church leaders in every order of ministry, especially our own vestry and wardens. For our parish as we discern a holy way forward. For Rector Marjorie and her family. For Linda, for the Thomas family, the Stalkup family, the Young family. For Ashley and Chris, for Kathy and for Jeff. For whom else shall we pray? I ask your prayers for all in need of God's healing power, for Carrie, Kate, Autumn, Frank, Judy, Marie, Warren, Lauren, Richard, Chrisanne, Kate, Jerry, Chris, Linda, Pat, Marianne, Linda, Al, Steve, Jackie, Linda, Patty, Ed, Eric, Mary Lou, Sandy, Melissa, Ken, and Presiding Bishop Michael Curry. For whom else shall we pray?
For John, for Nico.
I ask your prayers for all who have died, remembering all those killed in Morocco and Libya, and for the four young girls killed 60 years ago at the bombing of their church in Birmingham, Alabama. May the souls of the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace, and let light perpetual shine upon them. For whom else shall we pray?
For the victims of the Hawaii fires for rebuilding their lives.
Let us give thanks for all the blessings of this life, for the lives and memories of those for whom the flowers and sanctuary light are given, for Reverend Jamie's presence with us, and for this parish community. For what else shall we give thanks?
We pray for the gift of Shelley's sermon and the way that she has lifted up the gospel for us.
Thanksgiving for the New Hampshire School for Ministry as they prepare for another year of learning and vocational development. Amen. Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and on earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry.
Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Let us share with each other a sign of Christ's peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace, everyone.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. Proclaim the glory of your name. give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father,
we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory.
And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and the blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in this sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, blessed Michael, Gregory, William, Roger, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
"Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is power and glory forever and ever. Amen."
Alleluia. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
all of the children from our Sunday school to come forward for a special blessing of this day. I know you might be a little shy, but come forward, please. There we go. Come on, well, let's come right here so everybody can see us from online. I do. Just come on in. Great. Fabulous. This is amazing that you have a Sunday school, and I think this might be the first time you've been back since that which will not be named. And it's really great to have you here. So we're going to have a special blessing, and then you're going to help me do the blessing for the whole church. So gracious God, we lift up before you these children here, these students that are under your care. They stand here ready to go to school and be in school to receive your blessing as they commit their lives to studying and learning in the year ahead. We also think of all of their teachers and staff, bus drivers, and people in the lunchrooms, and all those who support you in your life as students. We ask your blessing upon them, God. Give them the grace to know that you support them. The blessing as they commit their lives to study and learning. We also pray for your backpacks that are in another room. Just think about them. And I know if you've seen children putting on backpacks, they weigh a lot times more than the children. So we really want to bless those backpacks. All the notebooks and the pens and the scissors and the crayons and the glue sticks and the textbooks, your lunches, your snacks, the gifts you give to your friends. As they carry these backpacks, dear Lord, give them peace when they're anxious, focus when they're maybe distracted, and energy when they are tired. And to remind them as they carry their backpacks, you always carry them. Amen.
Amen.
So if you could help me do a blessing, can you raise your hand? Live knowing that your God has created you holy, loves you like a mother and father, sustains you in the wilderness. And the blessing of God Almighty, creator, redeemer, and sustainer, be with you today and remain with you always. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
have a few announcements. I would like to thank Jamie for coming and being our interim and filling in with us. I would love to thank Paula for, with minimal, less than 24 hours notice. I didn't even know you were an organist. So we have people that get to know people and find out secret things about them. And Paula's spouse, Sarah, is helping us out in the office with the electronic craziness. And tomorrow, speaking of electronic craziness, is Marlene's, the start of her 24th year with us. So she has completed 23 years working with us, which is amazing. The Great Hall is still under renovation, so please avoid it for now so nobody gets hurt. Special thanks to Ken for getting the sound system to work in here so people didn't have to shout. That was wonderful. Quarterly statements were printed and I think mailed out this week, so you should get those. Stewardship is meeting next Sunday after church if you would like to be a part. I don't think they're turning anybody down. Sunday school started today and they're every other Sunday. And I don't know if everybody saw the email that went out. Betsy Stalkup did pass away on the 4th, Labor Day. Her daughter, they haven't decided on a service at this time. They have a lot of other things going on. Our mitten tree, there's a beautiful sign as you come in the door. We're trying to support 100 kids at $75 a piece. So, you know, write a check and put a note on it for the counters that it's for the mitten tree or the giving tree, and we'll make sure that gets there. I would love to thank any new people that are here. I think we have some, maybe. And we have committees and groups if you want to join. This week, the Bible study is meeting, and the book group is meeting this week. And 1269 still looking for underwear, and the Afghan population is still being worked with as well. So any other announcements? Stephen. Anybody else? Oh, Mark? Anybody else? Turn it over to you, Jamie.